Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome, Gemma, by teleconferencing. Just before we start, there's a couple of issues that have recently arisen, and one of the things that, just in case we get time compressed to the end of it. The first issue is obviously the Control and Auditor General's report on the LPS, and the fact that for somehow we've been managed to cross-subsidy BT to the tune of about 30 million quid for the last, since 2008. And the concerns I think that we all recognise is that we have had the head of LPS in front of us, and we have also had the permanent secretary in front of us, and the first we knew about it was the Control and Auditor General's report when it was published. So there are issues to do with that, and I'll bring that up later on during the meeting as well. There's a second issue that you'll be aware from the media, the issue about emails, and particularly emails being deleted after 3 months, and whether this is going to have any implications of some of the issues that we're trying to resolve and to look at. And as you know, I've written to the other party leaders asking them to have a meeting of the party leaders forum to discuss this, and also with the civil service, and agrees to do that. I regret to inform that I haven't had any response from any other of the party leaders, which I find is quite remarkable, but that is the situation we're in.
Deleted your email?
Obviously. And the third issue is on the item with the PPEs. Now, we will discuss the PPE, I think, at item 3 in matters arising. But you'll be aware, and the clerk has just circulated you a letter that's come from the minister, which we received, I think, at 11:10, 11:05, for a meeting today starting at 12:30. Welcome, Paul, to come in. We'll discuss that when we get to matters arising. Just before we get to that, I'll remind members the revised agenda was circulated on the 15th of June. I'll remind members of the content to proceed through the agenda as follows. First of all, apologies. No apologies. Welcome, Paul. Remind members they're obliged to declare any relevant financial or other interest at each committee meeting as applicable. Jim, take that as read.
Yes.
Okay. Any others? If we move to the draft minutes of the proceedings of the 10th of June, four members of the draft minutes of the meeting are on your papers at page 5. If members are content with the draft minutes or an accurate record of proceedings, if we agree, the minutes will be published on the website. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Great. Okay. First item number 3, matters arising, PP order, committee request for information. I'd like to advise the members a letter from the minister was received this morning at around about just after 11 o'clock, agreeing to the committee's request for this information. The minister is seeking the committee's assurance that the emails exchanges will be treated wholly in confidence, and that committee members will not discuss the content of emails outside confidential sessions of the committee.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask why.
I've just one sort of comment to make about this. For members of the committee to have a letter like this that has arrived with us just before the committee meeting, and speaking as somebody who has considerable concerns about how this assembly has been treated and the issues to do with scrutiny, and to me, if the letters PPE were changed to the letters RHI, and previously, if we had been given direction by the ministers, previous ministers of DETI or ministers of the economy to do something similar, and bearing in mind what has happened under the RHI report, this fills me with a considerable degree of concern. And it says a lot about what the minister thinks of this committee and our ability to do our work. But please open it up to conversation. Jim, sorry.
Mr. Chairman, you took exactly what I wanted to say word for word.
All right.
I think this is a very, very derogatory way to treat this committee. The DALO would have been aware of what was going on and reported back to the department immediately that we wanted this. And I think it's tactics to deliver it to us at the very last minute. Fortunately, I happened to be at home and had the computer on when I got the letter this morning. But I could have arrived here today and the first I'd have seen it would have been 5 minutes ago. That's not acceptable.
Okay. The comment. Matthew?
And I agree with the timing is not ideal. I think on the substance of the question about disclosure of emails, I think it's sort of not on... There is an argument that we can ask for an annotated explanation of why we are being, it may not be unreasonable to ask for certain things to be discussed in closed session and to be kept confidential. So I would want us to wait, though I agree that it's not ideal to get a letter at the last minute before a committee committee meeting, there does seem to be, and I haven't been shy in being critical about departmental handling, there does seem to be some movement on this and movement towards giving us emails, albeit they're being asked to remain confidential. It was my only comment, and that would be we would, I suppose, ask for an annotation as to, and an explanation as to why they're being asked to remain confidential. So while I agree the timing is not ideal, there is a bit of we are seeing some movement here.
Thank you. And just one comment just before I bring in the deputy. For those of us, and I know, Matthew, you've recently come to this assembly, for those of us even in the short time who were here for the period of time leading up to the collapse of the assembly over the RHI issue, a lot of the language that was being used and a lot of the flow of information, particularly with ministers to committees and the rest of it, there was a degree of obfuscation, to say the least. So one of the issues that we have is the ability of a committee and this assembly and other committees, because if this is taken as a precedent, where is this likely to go to? And one of the things I would like to have more information and I would like to have more advice in this before I took this particularly further. Paul?
Yeah, let's make no bones about this. This is simply a letter, even a holding letter, because they've heard, listening in last week, that we were going to commence Section 44. It's as simple as that. And we've had to go through that process or commence that process. And now they're looking at, well, how can we either stave them off or give them as little as possible? This is not acceptable. Never, ever in any democratic jurisdiction should this be acceptable, not least here after what we've been through. On the letter, I take exception to a number of things. They say in the second paragraph that they believed that they had delivered on the committee's requirements for the information. They have never ever completed that that ask, that request, because we had asked for all emails. Now they say that because of pricing, there's a real issue here with regards to this new company. Well, first of all, it warns us that this company is looking in and they don't want any negative press. How dare they? How dare they put negative press onto this scrutiny committee? Because the negative press has come from the department themselves, withholding information to this committee. Just give us the information we have asked for. It's as simple as that, because this is not now an issue about PPE. This is an issue about secrecy and lack of transparency. And the other issue then about costs, so if it is about a price sensitivity with regards to what they're now getting equipment for compared to what other tenders might have been, well then, is it not the simplest thing to give us all of the emails and redact the cost or the price? So you've the whole text with the pound sign or the euro sign, and the figure is redacted. Surely that solves the issue for them. And every day surprises me in this place. It really does. And this letter today received, of course, the timing is what Matthew has already alluded to. That's scant regard for this committee. That's total disregard and disrespect and contempt for this committee. And receiving letters at this time before our meeting is not acceptable. It's just not acceptable. And not the way to do business.
Thanks, Chair. So, I haven't had much time to read this like the rest of us here. So, I'm looking at the third last paragraph and taking on board what everyone else has said. And I'm looking at the word, just bear with me, will be treated wholly in confidence, and that the committee members will not discuss the content of emails outside confidential sections of the committee. Anything that we take, I would like to think that we would treat that was given to us in confidence, we would treat it with confidence. And maybe with that third paragraph, is there room? I would really like myself to have a legal opinion on that before we even move forward, even to discuss this letter.
Just for the advice of the committee, we can have legal advice for the committee next week. And I think we've arranged to do that, haven't we, Jim?
Sure, yes. Yeah, the committee has agreed to seek legal advice in Section 44, and legal services have said they can provide that next week. So if members are minded, to this letter can be added to that and a further request.
Are we agreed for this letter to be added to that?
I wanted to, yes, I'm agreeable with that. I wanted to comment.
Yeah, no, well, you're written, I think, yes. I'll continue. Yeah.
Yeah, that's been finished as long as we have agreed on that.
Lisa?
Yes, just through the chair, you won't be one but surprised to know that I'm of an entirely different opinion than MLA Frew. And that whenever he makes sort of those kind of comments in terms of the committee being treated with contempt and the likes of it, I don't agree with that, not in the slightest. I do think that if anything, that in many respects, the minister in particular and his officials and that as well too have gone above and beyond the call of duty in terms of providing us with as much information as is possible. Now, even within the context of this letter, you know, and I do think that there needs to be an awareness on people's part that that in fact we are dealing here with suppliers from China, and that we are involved in a world market as well too. And I think that if anyone has any sort of knowledge or background in their involvement with or their dealings with the Chinese, you may find that they do business in a very, very different way than what we might think that one would do business. The Chinese, and say to use the term that they use for it, put a lot of emphasis on what they call quanxi in terms of building up relationships and that with people before they even consider doing business with them at all. And the very fact that we were able to establish those lines of communications and that with the Chinese, and the very fact that we have had part of our order already delivered here has shown the success, in fact, of that whole process. Now, the Chinese can just pull down the shutters as quick as they pull them up, and in terms of, we'll say, the contact that they would have here with their suppliers and our own offices here, then they don't want that information being fed out to the rest of the world or even to their other competitors of that as well. And I can accept very, very much so that it is a reality that there are confidential elements contained within the relationship that they do have with the Chinese whenever it comes to the securing of orders. And it's quite obvious in this letter as well too that that same consultation has actually taken part, has included Dublin and the British office as well, and that they themselves are of the same opinion. Now, for us to pursue going down that line, where we're talking about emails about an order that never materialised, that didn't in any way cost any money whatsoever, but we're insisting on that line, hoping to bring it out into the open. And mind you, I would have to say to you, I wouldn't have the same confidence as probably everyone else in here that and had been dealt with in confidence that it would stay there, because already I would know that listening to the radio, to the Nolan show, or even reading in the local papers and so on, there's people here feeding information directly to some of these same sort of groups.
Would you let me call, just please, because I can tell you, I would feed out nothing.
Through the chair.
I can't speak for anyone else, but I would definitely, there's nothing would ever come from Pat Chatney, because I wouldn't be here if I thought that was the case.
I'm not suggesting you, Pat.
But you did, I know.
Can I continue? And that, and I do think that in receiving this letter today again too, that we should acknowledge that. And I do think too that through the chair, that we should acknowledge that in our pursuit of information about emails that have no bearing whatsoever on our current situation, that we are jeopardising the very thing that we hope to protect, and that is the continuing supply of PPEs to our frontline staff and that who will require them. They will require them, and that, no doubt about this, that is very much a possibility as well too, that we could jeopardise that very situation.
Thank you very much for noting. And just for a point of clarity, it's not a Chinese company, it's a Hong Kong company. There is a considerable difference, and Hong Kong companies have different work under different rules and regulations, particularly under the WTO criteria.
Sorry, just through the chair, whenever you say it's a Hong Kong company, I'm talking about a Chinese culture, which I'm sure applies to the people in Hong Kong, just in the same as an Irish culture would apply to us here in the north of Ireland or in Dublin or wherever else you might be.
I'm British. Through the chair. And Jim?
Yeah, I share the scepticism about the tactic of the timing. I think that's pretty obvious, to serve a letter an hour before the committee's pretty clear what's going on. It's also clear that the Minister's had to shift his ground. Last week he wrote to us saying he was seeking legal advice. It would appear legal advice has told him he's not on strong ground, as he's now offering to share. But sharing on the basis where we sign a blank cheque as to confidentiality, without knowing what it is we're signing that cheque for, that doesn't seem to me to be an appropriate way. But I do think that the Vice Chairman has hit on the solution of this matter, to say back to the Minister, you can redact the figures which inform the commercial sensitivity, and let's see the rest. I don't think any of us are interested, was the price £3.50 or £2.50 per item or whatever. We're interested in the shenanigans and what they were that were going on.
Do you wish, sorry, Sean?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. And just on that last point, the last member spoke, redact. I have no doubt, as soon as that would be, then that would be the issue. Why was this a redacted? He needs to come here. Mr. Frew said this is not an issue, but PPE, of course it's an issue. We're in a pandemic. We haven't been in one for 100 years, and we're dealing with a very important issue of PPE. And I wouldn't want to be part of any committee that's going to jeopardise that. And I believe this has become purely fishing expedition. That's what it is. And when Mr. Frew says he's surprised every day here, he must have been asleep during RHA. He must have been dumbfounded. This is about very sensitive information. And we had the Permanent Secretary in here last week, and she couldn't name companies. And this is about sensitivity. I think the Minister's in the midst of, he's only in the job a couple of months, in the midst of getting very important PPE. And as somebody who has two members within the household working on the front line, I know exactly how PPE is important to these people and the wider workforce within the. And I don't want to be part of a committee going into a fishing expedition, or will be responsible for jeopardising future. And I agree, still fear, I wouldn't be that confident that it won't go to the press. And you're listening and knowing one day. So that's how sensitive it is. It is a bit.
Gemma?
Yeah, can I just make a couple of points? I think, Chair, your comment about comparing this to RHA is a complete overreaction at the start. This isn't costing us money like RHA costs the public, so I think that's wrong. Another thing as well, Mr. Frew, and Sean has alluded to this, said that every day the Assembly surprises him. Well, I can't agree with that, but I can say that every week this committee and the behaviour of some of the members on this committee really surprises and disappoints me. The fact that we are still pursuing this issue is an absolute disgrace, and I'm not prepared to risk the supply of PPE to frontline health staff, and I propose that we move on to other issues because this is just ridiculous at this stage. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody wish to make a proposal?
Yes, I'd like to make a proposal that we note this as read and we move on.
Do I have a seconder for that?
Okay.
All those.
Sorry, Chair, just for the wording of the motion.
To the proposal to note the Minister's letter.
Yeah.
And to move on.
Move on.
We have all the that's the Minister's letter in relation to PPE, and I'd put the date on it, and that'll be. Yeah.
Sorry?
I'll add the date to note the Minister's letter relating to PPE of the 17th of June.
17th of June.
To move on.
Yeah. I do think that we've spent enough time in this completely and absolutely.
I mean, I had asked and we had agreed that we were going to come back with a legal opinion. I mean, could that motion not hold until we at least get that, Mr. McHugh? And then we could take a vote on the motion.
Chair, also, of course, last week we commenced Section 44 proceedings. So it's a wee bit silly, I think, at this point then to say we're moving on, especially when we haven't even had the emails yet.
Yeah, and that is the concern.
I think that in terms of noting the matter, as I said before, I think notwithstanding issues around the timing of the letter, there is movement from the department. Look, I'm don't come at this from the perspective of either trying to, you know, get at the minister at all costs or protect the minister at all costs. But just to be reasonable, they have said they will share the emails with us, and they have said that there will be emails that there are issues around these emails would remain confidential. I mean, my thinking, and I don't know whether legal advice is the right way to do it, given that they have, we talked about noting the letter, but they have actually said in the letter they want to share the email exchanges with us to be treated confidentially. Why aren't we saying yes, we'd like to see them, but asking for either as has been mooted, legal advice on what that means, or going to the department saying yes, but we would like, you know, it, further to your request for confidentiality, we would like clear annotation and explanation as to why these specific emails remain confidential, but you know, in principle, I'm happy to accept the principle that certain information may have to remain confidential. So I think there may be a way through this which is less dramatic than.
Yeah, look, it's quite obvious if we end up going to vote whether we're going to note it or not, we'll end up having a split decision. But the issue we have here is the question of, we haven't had the legal advice on this letter, on this issue that has come through. And speaking as the chair, and I hear what everybody says about PPE, and I've been involved in international trade deals with the Chinese for a very long time, so I know exactly what the situation is. But I also know exactly what the situation is with European countries, with the United States, with Canada and all the rest of it. The issue here is, I think, is more fundamental. It is the flow of information to this committee. The thing I have a concern about is if we agree to the contents of this letter, and I think the department has moved, it's moved a long way, to be able to agree to show us these emails under whatever caveats they are. There are wider implications for this assembly. There are wider implications for the committee in the process if we specifically agree to that and there's information that comes out of it. Much the way that anybody who was involved in the RHI process or any of the other Red Sky or whatever the other processes that went on in the past, that would have implications for this. So we do need to take legal advice. And speaking as the chair, I do not feel that I am sufficiently advised legally by our legal advice within the Assembly yet to make that call on whether we either note it or whether what we move toward or we accept what's being said within here. We have an opportunity next week to hear that legal advice when we've been discussing about the issues of Section 44. We have agreed that we'd be able to pass that letter on for further discussion. So I think that is the most appropriate position for us to do and to review it next week. And that, at that stage, this committee then can take a view on what the situation is. I also understand, and because this is in the record, and I will make this very clear, that whereas we know within the civil service that emails get automatically deleted after 3 months unless they're saved on TRIM, I would expect fully that the minister, the minister's office, the permanent secretary, and everybody who has any of these emails has saved them to TRIM. Because if there's any example of these emails being found to be deleted, I think we have real issues then. And regardless of what people say about PPE or whether about PPE orders, this is a much more fundamental issue. So that is my position as the chair. I would ask you as a committee for us to come to consensus is that we will leave this until next week and we have the legal advice that it's presented to us. Are we content?
Agreed.
Agreed. Okay, thank you. If we could move on to the next item, letter to the Minister of Finance and Minister for Health. I've had more changes of this in the last day going back and forth between Matthew and Alistair and various other people. Bearing in mind the time constraints we're at the moment, I would like the changes to be recirculated so everybody's had a chance to have a look at them, because Matthew's made a couple of changes, Jim's made a couple of changes, and I think it's more appropriate that we look at the changes. I mean, the thrust of the letter is the same, but I just want to see what the other changes are, and we can examine that out of committee if that can be circulated, Jim, if the committee is content. Content?
Okay. Good.
National Crime Agency has confirmed they will provide a written briefing on the 18th of June. The committee office will contact members to confirm the details of the meeting with the National Crime Agency on the 1st of July in Parliament Buildings. Thank you. Now, if we move on to the oral evidence of private members' legislation and the functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill, Strategy, Policy and Reform Division. Hi, Bill. Hi, David.
Hello.
Welcome. Team, we're welcoming here Bill Pawley, who's the Director of the Strategic Policy and Reform Directorate, and David Hughes, Head of RHI Inquiry Sponsorship Team for the Department of Finance. Just remind everybody that the item is being recorded by Hansard. I'd like to draw attention to the following papers relating to this agenda item. The Clerk's paper, the line of questions, and bearing in mind the caveat we've talked about, this is one of our final evidence sessions as we're working through, so please look at these very carefully. Line of questions on page 16, the functioning government bill, questions for Department of Finance on page 20, the Department of Finance's submission on page 25, and tabled at page 3, the Department of Finance's response to questions. Bill, could you make an opening statement, please?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Very briefly, really, just to note that the Minister and our Permanent Secretary gave evidence to the committee a couple of weeks ago. David and I report to them in their respective roles in the normal ways, and I suppose what they have said would overarch what we might say here in looking at things in more detail. And just would very briefly also refer to the committee to some of the generic issues that were raised in the Minister's cover note to the committee on the 27th of April, to note that much of what is proposed relates to the issues that were covered in the revised codes for ministers, SPADs and civil servants, and that they were completed after the talks process during last summer and reflected in the New Decade, New Approach document, where that document recognised the need for a new approach and a new transparency and accountability to what happened in the past, and that's entirely accepted. Also that having rules and standards for ministers, SPADs and civil servants is an important issue, as is its enforcement. And then a couple of points from his note of the 13th of June, the cover note there, the view that the codes sufficiently address the issues and that legislation isn't necessary, overarching what we might say in the responses to our questions, and that the codes will be re-examined in the light of the RHI recommendations. Thank you, Chair.
Okay.
Could I ask?
Yes, certainly. Yeah. Yep.
Thank you. Mr. Pawley, I want to return to the issue of the codes, because the Department's basic message is not so much to dispute the content of the bill, but to dispute the how of the bill, whether you need the legislation or whether it's sufficient to put it in codes. And the Department's basic stance is codes, even though they failed us in the past, are enough. But the codes that failed us in the past, when it comes to appointment, were even better than the codes that we have today. Because, as I put to you before, a very significant fact on the code for appointment of SPADs is that it stripped out all the process of selection by the minister. Now, 2 weeks ago, the former commissioner for public appointments, Mrs. Felicity Houston, whom you probably know, said this to the committee: we have to ask ourselves whether the code as it stands, this is the code of appointment, looks like a credible document in the eyes of the public. Does a code that sets aside all recognised appointment procedures because of the personal nature of SPAD appointment persuade the public that all is well? She went on to say, it would provide tremendous confidence for the public if they thought that in appointments like this, some sort of process could be seen and there was some sort of evidence of why X or Y had been appointed. And you're coming to this committee telling us you want to stand over a code which makes sure no sort of process can be seen in the selection and no sort of evidence can be available as to why X or Y was appointed. Is that seriously the department's position?
Firstly, on the point about whether really the difference really is codes or legislation, I think I would accept that. Certainly, as we said, and I said again in my introduction, we accept the need for change, as did the talks process that that these codes responded to, and the new decade, new approach document.
Just to put on the record, and I've already put this on record with the Minister, and I've already put this on record with the Permanent Secretary. Unlike anybody else in this room, I was actually sitting at the party leaders' group at those talks. The discussion about what we were going to do to restore accountability and responsibility to this Assembly and to control of ministers and the process of was not what ended up in the new decade, new approach, and was not what was in this code. So, and just so that is on the record, I want that made abundantly clear. So every time I hear an official turn around and say that this was agreed between the party leaders and by the parties as part of new decade, new approach, it wasn't. That's what not was agreed. And what ended up a new decade, new approach was something very clearly that the Ulster Unionist Party never signed up to. And it was something as a party leader I never signed up to. So right now, let's make that abundantly clear. I do not want to hear that put in front of this committee again. Sorry. I'm sorry for being angry, but I'm getting really fed up with this. Sorry, Jim.
As a civil service, just to respond in relation to that, we have, following the new decade, new approach document, which indicated that the codes should be put in place as a matter of urgency. That is what we as a civil service have put to ministers and asked them to respond to do. And all of the new codes and the supporting documents around them have been agreed by the executive and published, with the exception of the Code of Ethics document that is going through the agreement processes currently, and which has been provided to the committee because it does relate to some of the documentation. So that's what we've been doing.
Yes, but Mr. Pauly, I'm asking you...
And the codes have been agreed by the executive.
I know they've been agreed, but I'm asking you why, since Sir Patrick Cochrane in his report says the letter and the spirit of the codes need to be seen to be implemented, why, before that report was ever published, the executive had agreed to strip out of the code of appointment basic, what Mrs. Houston referred to as recognised appointment procedures, a pool of candidates, criteria, personal abilities, etc., all stripped out. Now, you cannot say that that is anything that strengthens the code, which is the protestation of the minister. He strengthened the code. In the code of appointment, he has shredded it.
The codes have been agreed by the wider executive, but yes, it was the Department of Finance Minister that brought them to the executive as proposed.
And you agree it's a weaker code in terms of its.
I haven't come to the Code of Appointment bit yet, as I responded to the bit and the element of. At the introduction, the first question that you put to me, which do we agree that broadly it's the issues as to whether it's a code or legislation? And the other point, I'm not sure if I made it or not, but I would say it again, but there are three clauses in the bill that are not covered by the code, if we understand it, which is relating to the reducing the number of SPADs, the power to make the special appointments, and the requirement to publish the biennial report. And it's our understanding coming here that those matters aren't covered by the code and wherever they might come to do it. In terms of the code of appointment, we believe it's a much simpler code, and we believe it reflects the reality of the situation in terms of what happens in terms of appointing SPADs. We believe it's consistent with the 2013 Act, in relation to SPADs. And in terms of the appointment, the code for the appointment of SPADs requires the appointing authority, which is the minister, to apply all appropriate employment law in the point at which, in their work to appoint their SPAD. That is a part of the code, and subsequent to that, the department takes over the work when we're informed by the appointing authority, which is the relevant minister, who the SPAD is, and the department takes the process from there, which is the code.
Mr. Pawley,
which is a much simpler version.
Mr. Pawley, the
and
code
reflects the
only
reality
kicks
of
in.
The
code only kicks in when the minister has handpicked whoever he wants, doesn't have to consider a pool of candidates, doesn't have to say what the criteria for the job is, doesn't have to assess the anyone against any criteria, doesn't even have to keep a note of why he made the choice he made. So please do not suggest to us that this code is compatible with good practice of the past, which had all those elements within it. It is weakening the code, it is not strengthening it, and anyone except the department, it seems, can see that.
The code requires that the appointment is made in line with employment law, all aspects of that employment law.
Yes. And what process? Well,
that's a statement in the code.
Let me move on. You mentioned one of the clauses that isn't compatible, that isn't covered by the code.
Yeah.
And that's the one of subjecting the prerogative, exercise of prerogative powers to assembly resolution. Now, we are a legislative assembly. And yet we have a situation where in the past and going forward into the future, there is the opportunity for the First and Deputy First Minister in secret, as they did with Mr. David Gordon, with no appointment process open to scrutiny, to make an appointment at £75,000 a year, as it was in that case, and never to even inform the Assembly about it. Now, what Clause 3 does is it makes any such proposal subject to getting the approval of the Assembly. Why would a department want to disbar the approval of a legislative assembly to situations such as that? Why would you want to hide that from the assembly?
We've responded in the comments that we've made to the committee in relation to this particular clause. I believe it would remove the power of the First and Deputy First Minister to engage, as we have said, any specialised expert support that they might need in some form of emergency or other situation in relation to such an appointment. We haven't got an example for you, or we haven't got a situation that might arise. There has been no such appointments made under this administration, and there has only ever been the one to which you have referred, where the normal processes of recruitment and appointment have since then been applied, and where the individual is advising one department as a civil servant in terms of that for the same individual. So the processes that exist can be applied to recruit experts when we have sufficient time and when it is appropriate to do that, to recruit the expertise we need. We are looking about how we...
Excuse me, Graham. That's like speaking to somebody who's been a chief executive and the rest of it, and you've had to bring people in at short notice. You bring them in on a consultancy basis. You don't bring them in as full-time employees. You do that in the civil service as well. If you have a specific area you need for somebody to come in, you bring them in on a consultancy service. You spend a fortune on PwC and giving money to them. Yeah. Bring it in a consultancy service. I don't get that.
That is another route by which specialist appointments can be made for temporary appointments for different periods of time in relation to...
So what you're talking is about short-circuiting the system so you can have a full-time appointment. So how is that following normal HR process?
That is an option that is open in the legislation that hasn't been used at this particular by this administration, and that has been used once in the past for the individual that Mr. Alistair referred to concerned within that. And as part of our wider thinking and looking about civil service reform, we are indeed thinking about how our civil service commissioners work, the role that they play, and looking forward to, for example, the number of exemptions to the merit principle that exist, the number of exemptions that are available to the civil service commissioners here is less than would be available to the civil service commissioners in Britain. And so that there are differences in what can be applied and expertise or whatever, and it takes you to look at some wider issues of getting the expertise that we need when we need it, which is an RHI issue in terms potentially as well, and leading to that and leading to civil service reform. And in this instance, this is the department's comment here is to note that it would remove this option from the First and Deputy First Minister's ability to appoint in this way.
And make it subject to the Assembly.
And to make it subject to the Assembly, and also to note that it is not a power that has been used.
Yes. So why are you so precious about it? And
we have not acknowledged that we're precious about the need for legislation in this area.
See, Mr. Pollitt, if you're concerned,
the overarching point about whether legislation is needed in this area to serve what we need in relation.
See, Mr. Pollitt, I could understand your position. The chair has pointed out you could simply go to consultancy, and there's no real answer that you couldn't. But I could understand your position if you're coming to this committee and saying, OK, we get it, that it doesn't look good to have prerogative powers exercised behind the back of the Assembly, and therefore, though we're concerned about the need for speed, we would suggest instead of a positive resolution procedure in the bill, you have a negative resolution procedure. I could understand you taking that stance, because that would maintain the role for the Assembly. But you're coming to this committee saying, we don't want anyone to touch the facility to appoint behind people's backs by virtue of the royal prerogative. And you're saying that to elected Assembly members who are supposed to make the legislation.
Do you want to phone a friend?
Through the chair, and please withdraw that remark. That is beneath you, Jim. Sorry about that. I apologise.
In relation to that, in relation to this clause, we have said overarching, we do not, as an overarching position, that we do not believe that legislation is required in this area or around it. In relation to this clause, to make legislation were it solely for this clause, we would point to the fact that it has been used once and not used now, and we point to the responses that
just
we
made.
Just
for clarification, has it ever, you said it hasn't been used recently, and you think there's only one example that has been used. Has there been any other examples that's been used?
Not locally, no. This is a bill of 2016. That has been used once, is my understanding, for the named individual that Mr. Alistair named, and that has not been used since.
If it's only been used once, why are you so determined to keep it in? I don't understand the logic.
We've pointed out in our response that it would remove this facility from the First and Deputy First Minister now.
But we've already explained. I'm the chair here. I've already explained that there is a very normal process that happens across all of government of bringing in consultants. And there is a process of bringing in consultants at short notice to do specific roles. You've explained to us that there's an issue here around HR issues. The only thing that would be protecting somebody who didn't get that role through HR issues was the fact that the royal prerogative had been used. So therefore, that would be the fence if somebody who decided didn't get the job had decided to take legal proceedings about it. So I am really struck by, if it's only ever been used once, why you want to retain this.
We're saying in the later responses to the question that there is a broader issue about how the civil service can recruit at short notice and at times the expertise that it might need. This is a facility that exists at the moment, has been used once, and not in the most current administration in terms of how we believe these things should be done and how in a reformed civil service or a new approach in this new decade, whatever the linkage to that might be. And I've pointed also to the fact that the civil service commissioners oversee how we appoint people to the civil service and the process of engaging in that. I've indicated to the committee that the list of exemptions to those where the full merit principle and the full application of recruitment processes have to be applied is less for us than it is in terms of Whitehall and other areas. And until such time as we look at wider civil service reform, we do not see a need to legislate, if you like, were it solely to remove this clause or solely in respect of this aspect of covering. As I've said, it's not something that we covered in the codes. It's not something that we covered in how we looked or responded to the issues in relation to it or how it became part of that process. It's something that was put in place, used once, and has not been used since. And there are, to my understanding, no plans in any department, but certainly not in ours.
The power still exists. See, that's understood.
The power still exists.
It wasn't just,
as we have acknowledged.
It wasn't just that David Gordon was appointed. It could have been anyone. It was that the First and Deputy First Minister made legislation.
To do it.
They exercised an executive power to change the Civil Service Commissioner's Order of 1999. And they made, by executive order, by prerogative order, a new piece of legislation called the Civil Service Commissioner's Amendment Order in Northern Ireland 2016. They made the law. They didn't tell the Assembly they had made it. And what this clause is about is making sure that they can't change the law again without the consent of the Assembly. It's as basic as that. But you want to keep a power created in that way, saying it won't be used, but it could be used. Chair, there's one other area, but I'm conscious of the proceedings, so I'll come back if there's time.
Yep. No, I'll give you the opportunity now to speak, Jim. No, just go ahead.
Okay. Clause 5, which is the one about suggesting we need a more objective process of investigating breaches of the ministerial code. The department's stance is we don't need Clause 5 because under new decade, new approach, we're going to appoint 3 new commissioners who are going to survey all these matters and deal with any complaints against ministers. Is it correct, Mr. Pawley, that whereas the standards commissioner, to whom I say that function should be given, is someone appointed by open competition in a transparent way, there is no such parallel with the handpicking of 3 commissioners by the First and Deputy First Minister? Secondly, that whereas the standards commissioner has the power to compel witnesses, to compel documents, to take evidence on oath, 3 commissioners have suggested a new decade, new approach, would have no such powers and can only ask the head of the civil service factual matters. And also that the commissioner for standards, for good reason, there are disqualifications about who can't hold the post, like somebody who was a former senior civil servant. In fact, there are 20 disqualifications listed in the legislation. There would be no disqualifications for appointing some suitable commissioners by the First and Deputy First Ministers. So even from the point of a presentation of objectivity. Is it not clear that giving this function to an independent standards commissioner would be far more presentable and acceptable from a public perception point of view than giving this function to three hand-picked commissioners who can't even compel documents, evidence, or take evidence on oath?
The proposed enforcement process that has been agreed by the executive includes provision for three, a panel of three, one of whom is in an ex officio role, the Assembly Commissioner of Standards.
Yes.
We believe so that that commissioner would be a part of the potential panel of commissioners who would look at this. We believe that it, as a rule going solely, and it was discussed during the talks process that was there in relation to this, that there would be a potential issue should the role of the Assembly Commissioner of Standards, who is responsible mainly, as I understand it, and I haven't looked at his legislation in detail personally, but for in terms of to maintain standards of MLAs, and to solely have that read across to be to maintain the standards in respect of ministers, could possibly lead to some areas where that was inappropriate, but we felt that it was appropriate that he should, he or she, or whoever is appointed to the role, should be a part of the panel, because it is likely that there could be potential breaches of the standards that would also be breaches in respect to the fact that the minister is also an MLA in relation to that. So that the nature of the panel that was proposed, it is there. It is a multiple person panel to allow different areas of expertise or knowledge of the individuals who would be appointed to be drawn off to carry out whatever investigation into whatever particular issue that the breach or the complaint that was made about in relation to that would be able to be the person best capable of investigating the matter that was there.
But without the power.
The role would require and would certainly it is envisaged that the role and that those people who would be expected to comply and to comply fully with the panel for ministerial standards, I think we call it, in relation to it, in terms of any of their investigation, and certainly when they needed to come to the executive secretary for any information or whatever, that would be fully complied with.
But Mr. Bowie, could I demonstrate to you the absurdity of this situation? The independent commissioner for standards investigating an MLA has the right to call for documents, to call for witnesses, to take their evidence on oath. That same person, ex officio as one of this trio of ministerial commissioners, if he's performing that role in respect of a minister, can't call for evidence, can't administer an oath, can't take evidence in the manner in which he can against an MLA. Is that not just absurd that ministers are treated with a kid glove approach of three commissioners who are toothless, with no powers, who depend on their facts, on what the head of the civil service tells them, as opposed to a commissioner who, when he's interrogating an issue in respect of a mere MLA's alleged breaches, has that whole panoply of powers? Is that not plainly absurd?
Can I make an observation around how this operates in other jurisdictions?
We're worried about here. It's here that's had the catastrophe of RHI.
Just to be aware, this committee has heard time and time again from the Permanent Secretary, the head of the Northern Ireland Civil Service, that Northern Ireland is a unique situation. Now, you are trying to tell this committee that it is not a unique situation. So please give us the benefit. This is a Northern Ireland situation, and it's been brought about because of RHI to make sure it doesn't come through again. That's why specifically we're doing that. Jim is still giving his evidence. I'll bring you back in a second, Jim.
I think the gentleman was wanting to reply. Yeah.
The experience in Scotland and in Wales, where independent advisers have been appointed, that has been, in Scotland in particular, that's been in a situation where it is the First Minister who has made the appointment for the investigation of the First Minister. And in that context, it has been publicly acceptable that, of course, the First Minister is going to appoint an independent advisor who is independent, otherwise that investigation has no credibility. And the two current independent advisors not only have that standing, but because of their background as prosecutors, carry that standing from their previous employment and their previous background. So I think it's important to recognise that there is precedent for the approach being taken, but actually an enforcement mechanism here where the panel actually has a greater capacity to bring things into the open than is set up in the Scottish context. And I think it's also worth noting that the method of appointment of the panel has not been settled. It's not explicitly set out in the enforcement method or the enforcement mechanism, but it hasn't been settled.
Is it going to be set in legislation?
I'm not aware that there are any plans.
No, it's going to be handpicked. You know that perfectly well. It's going to be three handpicked individuals picked by the ministers who themselves could be subject to a investigation, and if not them, the majority of the executive ministers come from the same parties. And those are the people who are going to handpick instead of an open competition, as you have for MLAs, and well dare an MLA step out of line, because then they're subject to the full panoply investigation, sworn evidence and everything else. But a minister might step out of line, and some handpicked individual with no such powers reaches some conclusion which they suggest to the person who appointed them, and the person who appointed them decides whether or not they'll take any action. Really?
I think we just need to be careful on our tone. And I, as a chair, I accept the fact that my tone has been slightly exasperated during this as well, but there's good reason for it. Melissa, okay. Go ahead.
Thank you.
Well, just through the chair, in fact, when I was interjecting, it was for that very reason, and I thought it downright rude that when this gentleman started to speak, as soon as he got the first couple of words out of his mouth, both you and Mr. Alistair were going down his throat. And I just thought that downright rude. And just in the information that you did provide to the meeting and that, I appreciated that in every respect. I also appreciate the fact too that we do look at what happens in other jurisdictions. While Sinn Féin stands for ourselves alone, we don't believe in reinventing the wheel. In other words, that we do look at what is happening in other jurisdictions, and that as well too, and look to the best possible practice in every respect. I just felt embarrassed there for a moment in the way you were being treated.
Good. Thank you very much indeed, Melissa. Your comments have been noted. I apologise if I have embarrassed anybody, but yet again, I state this is about Northern Ireland, and I'm not taking any more lectures about when we're told we're being in a unique situation and then being explained that we're not. Okay. Next up, Paul.
Thank you, Chair. Can I ask just, thank you very much, you're very welcome here. It's been very informative. Can I ask, Mr. Paul, are you here as an individual with all your years of experience and being the director, the role that you hold now, or are you here to represent the view of your minister?
I'm here to represent the view of our minister. That is the basis on which all civil servants attend all of these committees, and that's the basis on which I'm here.
So there would never be a time in an evidence session like this where you would actually say that the department is going a wrong direction, or the minister may well be incorrect in that?
No, I act under the direction of my minister. And as I said at the start in our opening statement, I referred to the fact that he was here a few weeks ago, along with my permanent secretary. I report to both of those people different ways, but I believe are widely understood in relation to it. And that's the basis on which I'm here and giving evidence to this committee.
Okay, thank you for clearing that up. That's been very helpful. Can I ask on the point about the appointment of a person of expertise? Now, I was part of the talks process, and you've already alluded to the talks process, and there was a lot of time where the language used in that was about co-design. Mm-hmm. How does this sit? How does this law or this rule, this royal prerogative, how does it sit with the aspect and concept of co-design?
This is the prerogative?
Yes, sorry.
It's not the wider bit about the codes and the practices.
No, the power to appoint a specialist.
It is not a policy that has been subject to co-design, as I understand it to mean when it's used in relation to consulting either with third sectors or how, when it was used, for example, in the draft programme for government and other things, that our policy-making process should be subjected to co-production, co-design, or the different terms that relate to approach to consultation with wider stakeholders.
Okay, so you've basically justified having this power by the fact that it hasn't been used this term, and it has only been used once ever. Am I correct in saying that that is what you said, that we've got this power, but it hasn't been used, except for once, and that was a one-off?
I don't think I ever said that this power was justified. At the point I have said, as reported in the response to the committee, that this is a power that if it was removed, would remove the capacity of the First and Deputy First Minister to appoint a specialist or expert, or whatever that situation might be in an emergency situation at this time. I've also said that looking forward, as is in the written submission that comes back, there are aspects of civil service reform. We were asked, what does it mean to be kept under review? And I've alluded to the fact that we believe the civil service commissioners and the requirements on our civil service for recruitment and our ability to recruit and the exemptions from the recruitment process where the full rigour of the merit principle must be applied are different here than they are to elsewhere. And if we are to have the expertise when we need it, at a time we need it, in order to take things forward expeditiously as possible in terms of that, there may be a situation in the future, but I have no example or no thought or know of no part of our current administration considering using this power at this minute in time.
Yeah. You started that answer by saying that you have never said that this is justified. Are you saying that it's not justified?
No. I am explaining the impact, as the department sees it, of this clause, should it remove this power from the First and Deputy First Minister.
Is that power, and again, I don't understand this, but does that power allow the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to appoint one person of expertise or more than one person of expertise?
It's only ever one at any time.
So, we've got a power, and you've painted a scenario whereby we're in a bit of a sticky situation. We really need to get expertise from somewhere. And we can't find it anywhere in our civil service. Anywhere. Is there not a real danger in appointing one expert, one scientist, one medical expert, when we can see clearly that science and expertise vary on any subject matter? So is there a danger that by plunking for one person to employ with the expertise, that there's a real danger that you're limiting your scope of expertise.
Yes, that would be a risk. In the scenario as you've painted it, to what you've outlined, I've indicated to you that I don't have a scenario where I can see where we would want to use this power again. But in the scenario as you painted, that indeed would be a risk, yes.
Is there any other way in the civil service where you appoint experts in a temporary fashion to get you through a period of review or emergency?
Yes.
Can you explain what those are, please?
The Chair broadly alluded to it and outlined it, that there are, through our procurement approaches, there are some framework contracts in place where for some types of expertise or individuals, depending on how they might be available or offering their services on that consultancy basis or not, depending on, there are contracts in place where we can access expertise. And indeed, that happens, I was going to say every day of the week, but that's common for that to happen, and happened many occasions, for example, during, as we have prepared for Brexit or other issues within it, when particular aspects of our expertise have been sought by the civil service. So, yes.
Yep. I mean, you say it's common. Is it comfortable within the civil service to perform, to instigate that function? Is it an everyday, mundane area of work? Nothing controversial about it, non-contentious. You basically just employ temporary consultancy in on a certain subject to advise.
Beyond the fact that the use of consultancy has been much criticised in the past the extent and nature of that, but it's not a controversial process. It's a common process. It happens often, but the overall levels of consultancy, etc., are something that is monitored because of those other wider uses, to see whether we're really using consultants, what could be done internally, etc.
One last question. You're here on the behest of your minister, but when you read through your answers and what we have on our table paper, and your answers in red, there's an awful lot of them that starts off, the minister has the power. You as a civil service, bounded by your minister, is there a concern when you're talking about other ministers having the power to...
Sorry, can you point us to which examples? I know that some sentences start for different reasons that way.
Yeah, well, I read it earlier. It's tabled papers. I certainly was paraphrasing there. I wasn't. Let me just check. Yes. So, clause 1 to 2, the terms of the role within government, individual SPADs are accountable to the minister who appoints them. Clause 1.3, ministers are responsible for the conduct and discipline of their special advisers. The next page, while the investigation of misconduct may, for instance, be undertaken by a civil servant, the minister is ultimately responsible for the discipline of the special adviser through the civil service may be expected to contribute. So, the D question there, all ministers have agreed the current code and conduct. So we're putting a lot of weight on ministers here, all ministers.
Well, under the answers there under clause 1.3, excuse me, referring to all ministers or the minister who has appointed the special advisor, and that's a point on which I think everyone has agreed there has to be absolute clarity that the appointing minister is responsible for the discipline of a special advisor, and then obviously the answer there on subparagraph D is how the executive has agreed the codes and guidance that exist. There will be some places where the answer refers to the Minister of Finance, who has responsibility, for example, in, I can't think of an example in this, but for example, the publication of the Civil Service Code of Ethics, that's a Minister of Finance responsibility or Department of Finance responsibility under his direction and control. So I think it depends on context, obviously, but there are areas where the Minister of Finance has a responsibility, and there will be some answers here where it's an answer that has come from the Executive Office and therefore has been seen and agreed by First Minister and Deputy First Minister because it's in respect of the remit of the Executive Office.
Okay, that'll do me, Chair. Thank you.
Jim?
You've watched this place collapse for years on the back of absolutely appalling behaviour by SPAD. And you're now sitting here advocating no real change, just a slightly beefed up code, a code to cover the affairs of the SPADs. You've looked uncomfortable throughout the hearing, and you're a gentleman of vast experience. You've been around here longer than me, and that's saying something. Around here, I don't tell you how long I've been around here, but you've vast experience. Are you uncomfortable with some of what you've been asked to say here this afternoon?
No.
No. So you, in your inner self, having witnessed the absolute chaos that SPADs have caused to the devolved government of Northern Ireland, are personally standing over what you've been asked to say in this committee?
Subject to the comments the Chair made about the new decade, new approach agreement, during the period of suspension in the civil service, on a number of occasions, through our head of the civil service and others, called and made it clear that the civil service wanted our institutions back just as much and, if like, more than anyone, and in terms that we needed that. I fully concur with all of those things that were said and did it. We value our institutions, we appreciate them, we live here too. These things are very important to us in relation to it. New decade, new approach did begin with, as I've intimated, that there was an acknowledgement that change was necessary from what happened in the past in relation to what you're referring to. There are a couple of instances, and I don't want to start to split hairs, where the questions that were posed to us by the committee talked about in light of previous events. My understanding is that people are referring there to the RHI situation and others, and we confine it to that. Our department, my minister, the executive, have accepted all the findings of the RHI inquiry at this minute in time. And there's, what, 377 of them? We have said that we accept the findings of it. That is accepted. And I believe the new decade, new approach, whatever it's standing, a little bit of doubt raised here about what its standing is in terms of whether it was an agreement or not, but this agreement indicates that people would come back to approach our institutions and to deliver public services again in Northern Ireland from an approach that was changed in terms of what happened during the period of time that where the RHI situation emerged and more broadly. So if that can be delivered, do we want our institutions? Yes. Do I personally want them? Yes, I do.
That's not the question asked. Are you comfortable with what you've been asked to say?
I'm comfortable with the basis of the new decade, new approach, that people said stuff and things that happened had to change and respected the change. And in all of this, I actually personally believe if we're going here, whether it's legislation or codes, if people don't change and respond to that change, then if they're committed to behaving badly, people break laws every day, common, all over the place, in relation to it, just as much as they may break codes or others, but they have to be committed to all of the institutions. And I think that's ministers, SPADs, I think it's civil servants, and actually I think it's members of the Assembly as well, and how we treat each other every day, and we have questions about that here today as well in relation to it. So across the full gambit, there has to be a new approach.
Now, one of the things that's emerged is during the whole Red Sky issue was the conduct of Stephen Brimstone. And what emerged, we're not interested in the actual facts there, but what we are interested in is the fact that conduct was alleged which fell far below the standards that were acceptable from special advisers. But at the end of the day, the only person who could take disciplinary action against Mr. Brimstone was the minister, and his minister opted not to do that. How does that change under your code?
Absolutely. Can I pick up on that? I think the critical change that has been seen is in the change to the ministerial code of conduct, where it is made clear there. That the minister is required under that code of conduct to ensure that the rules on the management and conduct of special advisers, including discipline, are adhered to.
And who forces the minister to do that?
Well, I understand that a failure to fulfil the terms of the ministerial code of conduct, then it is a breach of the pledge of office. And one deals with a breach of the pledge of office through the assembly rather than any other mechanism. Now, obviously, an enforcement mechanism has been designed to be introduced, which can, if necessary, help that. But the, as it were, the disciplinary authority for ministers rests in Section 30. I'm sure someone will correct me if I've got that one wrong. Section 30 of the Northern Ireland Act, where it falls to the Assembly. But that's new. That insertion into the ministerial code of conduct is new, where it was never expressed so clearly at that level and with that degree of impact, where a breach might have taken.
And what happens if the minister decides not to let the assembly know what's been going on?
Our response to the committee states here that there would be a key role for the civil service in this process, depending on the nature of the behaviours or other. For certain behaviours like bullying, harassment or other things, no matter who it was being carried out by in our workplace, it can't be tolerated and can't be accepted, and that the civil service, if and when necessary, would intervene, would go to the minister, if necessary, would go to the head of the party. It can be reported to the ministerial standards, whose investigation would then be made public in relation to the enforcement process that was outlined. It didn't come back at the time when we were asked, but our enforcement mechanism, while there are features of it that you credit, there are parts of it that are much stronger than elsewhere in that anyone at all can make a complaint. It's not confined to the Prime Minister or the head of government as elsewhere, and the tight timescales within which those investigations must be carried out or indicated that should be carried out in order to do that, so that whatever failing existed, it would be a role for the civil service to, if you like, call it out, to say again, and if the minister wasn't taking action, to take further action to intervene to say that this behaviour cannot continue in our workplace, in and around it. And the nature of different breaches, you know, the codes of conduct cover stuff from how we conduct ourselves every day, just and interact with people, through to stuff that could potentially be illegal.
And is that the same radical action was taken when they discovered there were two super spads operating on the Falls Road and information been taken Stop Castle?
What Jim, happened
Jim,
in the past?
I think that's. I think we've
okay, made
a right. Point
well, I'll move on to the last question. The whole argument you're dying in the ditch over here, and I think you're very uncomfortable about dying in the ditch about this, is whether this should be statutory code or legislation. We're all dancing in that head of a pin. The best legislation is legislation that never has to be used because it's a deterrent. You haven't convinced me that you can have the best of the both worlds. You can have your statutory code, and overarching that, you have legislation so that when somebody steps out of line, you've got that ultimate deterrent of a court case, with all of the evidence having to be collected, the cross-examination, the disclosure of all documents. That is a real deterrent, far more so than any civil service investigation. Why can you not accept your idea of a code and Mr. Alistair's overarching legislation? What is wrong with that?
I've addressed the question previously as to whether I was uncomfortable or not.
deviating from the basis and principles of which I am here, which is under the direction of my minister in relation to it. And the position of my minister is that we do not believe that legislation is necessary in this area. The executive has agreed new codes. They've agreed in other areas that there needs to be a changed approach. They have agreed that there needs to be increased transparency and accountability across a whole range of areas that needs to be applied. I am entirely comfortable and agree with the fact that those changes need to happen and need to be taken forward.
But if your code is going to be so successful and so effective, why are you worried about there being legislation which may never have to be used?
I just wanted to add a point there about the deterrent effect of legislation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think we also have to bear in mind the chilling effect, as it were, the deterrent effect on someone doing the right thing, which may fall foul of the legislation, but maybe the right thing to do in the circumstances. And a code allows for the interpretation of what those rules and that
and
breach
so
might
be. Legislation. And
but
so can legislation.
Once the legislation has determined that something is wrong, there may be a defence, absolutely. But having to consider the defence may well be the deterrent or chilling element in someone doing the right thing.
Okay, thanks very much, Nate. Matthew?
I'll be very brief, thank you, Chair. Just on the thing we were discussing earlier, Clause 3, and the prerogative power to basically appoint civil servants. Has that... You said that, just so I'm absolutely clear, because I wasn't in Northern Ireland, never mind Northern Ireland politics at the time, David Gordon's the only time that's ever been used.
That's my understanding.
Are you aware of any other discussions where it's been used, where it's
no.
been considered? Fine. So the purpose is there to appoint someone to a civil service role because there are provisions where, as the chair mentioned, you could appoint someone as a consultant. You know, you need someone from PwC, or you need an actuary for something, or you need a lawyer, or you need a whatever. But this is about having basically the legislative power to appoint a civil servant in extremis. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
And are there any other kinds of? I know you sort of talked about this earlier, but David Gordon is a former journalist, basically a comms person, press officer. Wouldn't demean that either those rules because I perform both of them myself. But what other? And of course, I would regard them as highly expert and specialised rules, but other people might not. what other kinds of roles would you imagine that power would be used in? Given that if the department has responded that effectively it believes this power should be retained, whatever about the transparency issues about it and the irregularity of it, what are the kinds of roles that you might foresee them it being used for?
I indicated I didn't have
an
example or a role. I know the types of roles that it's common that the PwC type person, there was expertise in trade recruitment to the Department for the Economy on Brexit type issues, etc., for example, using those routes. And as I indicated, I can't just think of them as I'm here. The list of exemptions that is available to the Northern Ireland Civil Service through our Civil Service Commissioners to the merit principle is shorter and doesn't include all of the aspects where those same exemptions can be applied by the Civil Service Commissioners in Britain.
Mm.
And so the use of exemptions as a means of expediting a recruitment process is something that is permissible by Civil Service Commissioners and under the approaches, and just how and why ours is different is a question that we are thinking about, among others, in relation to future civil service reform. So to compare the two lists of exemptions, you will get a couple of categories they have we don't have that might be in the area that you would want them. We'd be happy to send you the two lists that you can see.
Yes, please, thank you.
You know, yeah. They're different.
Thinking about it, just there are loads of examples, and I wouldn't ask you, but you think about loads of examples in Whitehall where a body is set up and an appointment is made. Now, is that done by... No, it was unfair to ask you that question. For the sake of argument, a few years ago, the UK government set up a body on infrastructure and they appointed a man who's an ex-minister, Andrew Adonis, Lord Adonis, I think, to be chair of that. I presume that wouldn't have gone through an open competition based on civil service rules. If a similar public body was set up here, is that provision more limited in terms of making that appointment? Or so I suppose what I'm trying to get at is I really can't see why this power is required, given that we're all finding it quite hard to name an example where it would be used.
Mm. No, I think the example you describe is much more akin to a public appointment, particularly if he was to be paid, as I imagine he was, then it's certainly a public appointment as opposed to an appointment to civil service. There are many people who sit in advisory panels for the greater good. In relation to that would come and provide those services free, or some hours a week, or if it's related to another role they have. So there's numerous scenarios where you can have advice and expertise, and we get advice next. We get experts writing to us every day with their views about things that should be different. So,
yeah. One just final question. There's no rule which says that a special advisor has to be a party member or even sympathiser, really. There's no... a special advisor does not have to...
No.
It just happens to be the case here that DUP, Sinn Féin, SDLP, UUP special advisors tend to be people who have worked for, sympathised for, been councillors for those parties, but that isn't always the case in special advisor appointments. And it could be that the fast or urgent appointment where First and Deputy First Minister decided they needed a particular bit of expertise, David Gordon or anyone else, they could appoint them as a special advisor, and they would have to obviously comply by the special advisor code or the updated legislation that Mr. Alistair is putting forward if it passes. But that appointment could be made, couldn't it? They could be appointed that way.
I believe so, and indeed, when developing and considering the salary scales in respect of special advisors, and as we looked at other jurisdictions, the existence of more than 1 point or 2 points or three different pay bands took into account that special advisors can bring expertise as well as bringing the political perspective to it. And indeed, some of our special advisors, as well as being party members, do have an experience and a background in the area to which they've been appointed as special advisors.
Indeed, but I suppose it would make the point, I'll be very quick, sorry, I know Sean Mustang as well, is there a degree of circularity around saying that I'll let Sean in because I know he wants to make a remark. I think I've asked enough questions.
Okay, thanks very much indeed. Sean?
Thanks, Chair. I know most of the questions have been clarified for myself here today, but I think Bill made a very good point. Whether you have legislation or you have codes, if there's a culture of bad behaviour out there, that's a different thing. It'll not change. And I know Mr. Wells brought up about what do you do with a minister. I think we know the case he was talking about, and the final arbiter in these cases first that are elected. I think the people of North Belfast decided in the end of the day their result on the minister. And
Wrong minister.
Sir, hold on. Sorry, go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, that's just wanted to say it doesn't matter whether it's code or legislation.
Sir, listen.
Just in fact, Falter Rose and Sean New Foster, you're very welcome here this evening as well. And more or less just to reinforce that very point that that Sean was making, that a lot of our discussion here was about the appointment of special advisers, and I think that Matthew maybe even was expanding that as well too, that a special adviser in many respects as well too doesn't have to have a particular qualification. That you may find people experts in certain fields, and some of them very, very significant in many fields that might not have a particular qualification when it comes to GCSEs, A-levels or degrees or the likes of it. But that in moving away from, we'll say, looking at the appointment of advisors and qualifications, it is, in fact, and I think that you sort of less confirmed that yourself, that in this New Deal, your arrangement, that what is required is a change of culture. And that whenever another speaker was alluding to Mr. Brimstone, or was Mr. Brimstone or Mr. Johnson, as reflective of a culture. And that is the very thing, it has to change in every respect. And in making that comment, I'd just like to go on to say as well too, that that same speaker who had talked about Mr. Brimstone, he used an expression again about two special advisers on the Falls Road. We don't have any special advisers in any office on the Falls Road operating independently of this institution one way or the other, and I want to refute that entirely.
Thank you, Matt. Pat?
Thanks very much, and it's not an attack, I'm not coming back, but in the private sector for 85 grand, I'm telling you, I would want them to have all the qualifications they could get and all the skills and all of the experience that was necessary. Under this code here on the appointment, what's to prevent? I mean, what's to stop a minister from just appointing a chum, a friend, a mate, to bring them in with no qualifications, no special skills, and no experience? There is nothing.
What the minister does before he informs the civil service of the appointment and how he considers the job, the role against it, there is nothing there. The civil service role begins when we're told of the appointment. Issues like that would be taken into account as we determine the salary.
But I'm not speaking about this minister, I'm speaking about all ministers. All right? I mean, yes. It's not the one that I'm just looking at here. I'm just looking for good government out of it all. How do you respond to then? I know that Mr. Alistair brought it up on that point with the Commissioner for Public Appointments. As you've seen with the publication of the Code of Appointments, Special Advisers, if a code is basically silent under procedure, then it can be very easy to comply with.
I think
it's number four.
Yeah. The role that's set out in the code, the Special Adviser Code of Conduct for Special Advisers, begins very deliberately by setting out the valuable role that special advisers can play and are expected to play in good government, and sets out what they can bring to that and the interaction with the civil service and ministers when there are places where it's difficult for us to go, that they can go and that aren't the ministers in relation to it. So that is a very valuable role in decision making and in the process of good government here in relation to it. Our expectation is that the job description, if you like, for special advisers is the code of conduct for special advisers, where paragraphs, I think, 1 to 4 of that document set out the role that they're supposed to play, and also have in it some things that they can't play in relation to that. So our expectation is that people would be recruited to that role that can perform those functions in relation to it. Now, the merit principle is set aside for SPADs because it is entirely accepted, I think, by all that these special advisers should have a similar political affiliation or outlook as the minister himself that we'd had in order to advise them on that. And so special dispensation from the merit principle is allowed, but as was alluded to by you earlier, that could mean that they have no qualifications at all. But I like other areas, I can't see a scenario where anyone would want to do that. They would they would be left with a fistful of executive papers twice a week at the minute with little advice on them.
I'm still all right, Chair, just because I was wondering, have you looked at, can we get a criminal offence out of this, out of your code, and is there a tariff, or what fines, or...
For a special advisor, there are sanctions that can be applied if they behave badly in different ways. Most of those relate to the fact that complying with the special advisor code and, for special advisors, the civil service code of ethics is a part of their contract. And in terms of ways in which people can be disciplined for misconduct, or the documents that we've had and the questions we had were about misconduct. And
it's up to the minister to terminate that contract?
No, the investigation we anticipate or would expect would be carried out. Normally, if it's about something that happened in the civil service.
Yeah, because the minister is ultimately responsible for the SPAD.
Yes.
So if the SPAD has done something that breaches the civil service code of conduct, therefore, by your legal definition, yes, he's in breach of contract.
Yes.
So therefore, he's in breach of contract. So who therefore terminates his contract? Is it the civil service or is it the minister?
It ultimately has to be the minister who does it, because he is the appointing authority.
Right.
But there are places in that. I think the last question of a series of five, and one of the ones is, would it be acceptable for it to happen that no action was taken? And our response there is a clear no, that the civil service would have to take that issue further, that there are certain behaviours and things that we cannot allow in our buildings among and with and alongside our employees. There are standards of behaviour and conduct that must be observed. They're slightly
so for instance, if somebody did something, let's say, a breach of cybersecurity or computer security, or did something along those lines, so it's a very definite breach of the civil service code, and would you be allowed to exclude them from the building or from the system, or would that be a ministerial decision?
The ultimate application of the sanction would have to be for the minister.
Okay. So just to move on to the next, and Pat, I'm sorry, I appreciate this has been quite a long day for it, but one of the questions we have to ascertain is, obviously, the ultimate sanction is that the minister doesn't do it. They come before the Assembly. But what sanctions do the Assembly have from the minister who doesn't, if the SPAD has made a breach of the code of conduct? What sanctions does the Assembly have? Because, I mean, from the way I read it, is the ultimate sanction is if the minister doesn't do anything about the SPAD, the minister somehow ends up in front of the Assembly, and the Assembly then decides. So what's the sanction the Assembly can use?
I would have to go back to the Northern Ireland Act, and I think it's section 30.
Yeah,
My recollection is that it is suspension up to 12 months, and that can be renewed, but apologies if I can't say that with absolute confidence. It's a long time since I looked at it. So effectively, removal from office for a period.
But it would have to be by cross-community vote within the Assembly.
Yes.
There's certainly a threshold.
Yeah. So there'd be a considerable threshold too. Okay. We just needed that to do that as well. Pat's that finished?
Well, it was. Thanks. The last piece of this is I want to find confidence built into this and into the foundations, if you like, of where we are or what we're trying to do here as legislators.
Yeah.
But I can't see where the policing is on this if it does go back to a minister, because if they have appointed the commissioners, as you've already stated before, you're following your direct line from your minister. There's no guarantee that we as a committee, as the Legislative Assembly, can overturn or overrule or speak of any wrongdoing that's put out or that has happened. How do we I'm looking for sanctions, I'm looking for tariffs, I'm looking for some accountability in this, and there doesn't seem to be anything there. And that's why I find myself, sorry Chair, it's an observation, that I find myself supporting Mr Alistair's bill the more I hear of this now.
The sanctions that can be applied to any civil servant are set out in our handbook, and they range from a verbal warning through to a written warning, through to a formal written warning about the nature. And those can be about attendance, they can be about how, whether you've bullied staff, whether you behaved inappropriately like that in relation to it. And there's an overarching term of degrees of misconduct in relation to it. There's also the elements about either email security or if you're in breach of your code in relation to gifts and hospitality.
But
or
I think the difference, and again, this speaks back to the role of a consultant. So if you bring a consultant into an organisation, they abide by the terms and rules and conditions of the organisation. The difference here is that if the SPAD does something wrong and breaches the civil service code, unless the minister agrees to sanction them and agree with the sanction, it has to go all the way up through the minister being hauled in front of the assembly to go through all the process to get to a cross-community thing. That is the problem with the code.
If we all behave differently.
Yeah, but we don't, so.
No, if people are saying they're not going to, and our parties here are going to be saying that, well, yes.
Yeah, I mean, the problem, and it comes back to, we've had an example, and I'm really sorry for keeping for this length of time, but this is an important piece of legislation. And I think, as Pat has alluded to, the more we've heard evidence, you know, I started off as being quite agnostic about this legislation, and the more I've heard, the more I'm becoming convinced that it's important that we go down the legislative route. But, you know, we've already heard, you know, we're trying to sort of extract emails from the department. We're trying to do all sorts of things, and we are not seeing this change in culture. And that every time anybody comes to this committee, they keep on saying it's a cultural change and everything's changing. And, you know, and look, I put my hands up, and I'm not being party political about this. I'm putting this as somebody who really wants to see Northern Ireland work and Northern Ireland work well. And I am not seeing this change of culture. And that's what's bothering me. Now, I appreciate we're moving on fairly rapidly now to look at in-year monitoring, but Bill and David, thank you very much indeed. I know we've probably been slightly more robust than we would like to be, but please take an apology from me to that as well. But thank you very much indeed for coming, and look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you. Cheers. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, team, next thing in the agenda, number 5, oral briefing, in-year monitoring, June monitoring round, and this is the oral evidence from the Finance Division only, not the overall departments and the rest of it. Can we bring in Stuart and Janice?
They'll be quick in their boots after that.
Go in, Stuart, come in, and Janice, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
I'd like to draw your attention to this agenda item that's been recorded by Hansard. I'd like the members' attention to the following papers related to the agenda item. The Clerk's paper, the June monitoring round, is on page 40, and the Department of Finance June monitoring round and budget reprioritisation position is at page 42. And over to you, Stuart.
Okay. Hopefully you have the briefing that we sent through, so
yep.
I'll just take you through that. And
yes, please.
High level. As you know, the Department, obviously, our opening resource baseline is about 168 million, 167 or 69 million. So we were looking at how we could manage it. This was really a joint process between June monitoring and the reprioritisation exercise, which you explained when I was here last time. So the Department have been taking forward, first of all, looking at the pressures that we had, and those we reckon amount to about 39 million. They're in the table below, the biggest one being the rate rebate. Now, the rate rebate is a consequence and why it's increasing of people being on universal credit, where there is either a cash amount paid to people or a reduction in their rates. So we're seeing that because of the number of people on universal credit, that's going up all the time. So we can't be specific on how much that is. So it's quite like could be quite a range between, say, 14 to 24 million. Next one then is the LPS income. Now part of that is because of the building being closed, land register being closed, and obviously the housing market not operating at the moment. Part of it, that's account for about 7 million, then to say a further million coming from ordnance survey and commercial side not operating at the moment, and a smaller amount from valuation. Then we have another a number of other smaller pressures there. Relief fund to suppliers, which is almost like a form of furlough, and it's basically to keep firms who are carrying out maintenance work going, so they don't go to the wall and they'll be available to come back to. So the firm can't claim both furlough and that amount of money, just to be clear on that.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's some general registry office would be another pressure where, again, that's a consequence of the public office being closed. People can still go in and actually register births and things like that, but the actual income is made for the certificates that are produced on that, which they aren't able to do at the moment. So that they're estimating the first quarter was about 0.7, so 700k actually lost on that, but looking forward they reckon it could be up to about, in totality, 2.4 million, keeping an eye on those. And then the other pressures, there's some other, some non-COVID pressures, if you like, which include IT systems, so keeping the IT systems up to date, and some relating...
Hopefully not from BT.
Well, not all.
Maybe they can give us some of the 30 million back.
Well, we're sort of working on some of those. I know they are having discussions.
Sorry, I apologise for slightly flippant but remark.
I would fully expect those sort of questions after the headlines in the paper. And then some exit costs from contracts coming out, and then smaller amounts relating to IT in smaller areas. So basically what we're saying, we've about 39 million of pressure, so we are looking to meet as many of those as possible. So the totality of savings has come to in and around 18 million that we've identified at the moment. Large chunk of that is from vacancy management, which is looking at going forward. There's obviously going to be a small, the number of processes going forward to fill vacancies is going to be slowed up. So we've asked people to reprioritise, and when they're bringing people in, also relook at processes and things. Well, what can you do without for them? It's important at the moment. So that's a big chunk. Another chunk is GAE. About 6.1 million, where we're actually looking at people aren't in, so they're not travelling at the moment. There's not other expenses that are going on. There's some slippage in some programmes because of the current situation. So that's adding up to about a chunk there. So, and then we've also gone back to departments. That came to the overall to about 14 million. We've asked other areas to go back and look, given the situation, to bring forward, say, about another 4 million based on further slippage in programmes going forward. So overall, we've identified about 18 million of savings. So the approach that was agreed with the Minister then was to, at this stage, meet those pressures that we can with the 18 million, but to flag up the amounts for the rebate and the LPS income. At the moment. Now, we can't be definitive in those amounts, so we haven't actually bid for them, so we've just flagged the high-level pressures with the centre, because those could go up and down depending what way universal credit goes or what way housing market goes. So we can't actually bid for what we don't know is happening at the moment. So that's generally on the resource side. On the capital side, a bit more straightforward. We had about 28 million. Now, we started off with an opening capital pressure of 2 million, which we thought we'd probably be able to cover through some slight slippage programmes, as it's generally the case in large capital programmes. But there has been further pressures identified, the main one being actually buying laptops for the civil service to try and cope with the current position. What this current situation in COVID has actually shown is that there maybe was an area that we need to cover where more people can work from home if there is such a situation arises again. So the use of laptops has enabled people to do that and carry on business as usual in many cases. So that there's around 3 million would be a pressure on that. But then another side, because of slippage in programmes like NOVA and shared services, smaller projects, we have some slippage there. So, and overall, it's a net position of, say, about a 1.3 million pressure, which added to the 2 million at the beginning of the year. We reckon we probably have 3.3 million pressure at the moment in capital. But again, we haven't bid for that because we are looking to sort of absorb that in year and see how programmes go. If there's any further slippage, we hope to be able to meet that from it or review it again in October monitoring.
Okay.
So that's a quick summary. So happy to take any questions on it.
Okay, Pat.
Thanks very much, and thanks very much for your presentation. I've just, I think you might have, but can you help me just with vacancy, that term vacancy management? Is that the money that is still is within a said department?
Yes, well, basically within your budget you have a certain amount for staff costs,
yeah.
And that will include staff that you intend to bring in at certain times during the year, so you will be funded for those salaries. What we're saying is, well, those staff maybe should have started in April, but there's obviously not starting in April, and some of them may not start at all this year, but the money
is there.
It was allocated.
Just, so. See, there's 5.1 million in what you've said there. Yeah. So that is available, that is there. Is that coming back into the centre?
No, what we're saying is we're using that 18 million to offset the 39 million worth of pressure, so we're not bidding for those pressures we have. We're using it as an internal way of filling.
And just one more. And then there's 4 million needed to be found. Where will that come? Where is that going to come from?
Well, again, we've gone back out to business areas to say, have a further look at your vacancies and things. You know, we've moved on a bit further now. You know, are we really going to get very many vacancies filled this year? Also, on your GAE, there's certain things we think, your general admin and expenses, I should say, which is travel and other, you know, day-to-day expenses. You're not going to be having the same level of expenses. So we're asking them to go and look closer at those and come back with better estimates.
And last one, Chair, if you allow me, just for on the, if, I don't know if you'll be able to answer it or not, but are there pressures mounting on finances on the hardship fund, which is out there for sole traders? Maybe, is that okay?
Well, I couldn't answer, well, you can ask one. It, but I can't answer. That's more DFE.
Yeah, I understand. But I mean, the money is going to be asked from yourselves. I mean, has there been an ask from that at the moment?
I don't know.
We're going to talk about do that about next week.
Right,
yeah,
right.
Sorry.
Okay, sorry about that. Jim?
I'm intrigued what you said there about the increase in rate rebate applications. I thought that was AMI money that came directly from London as social security payments. If someone applies for a rate rebate, do we take a hit locally?
Yeah.
So it comes out of the block grant?
Yeah, and it's scores and Dale. Yeah, and we get the money transferred from DFC into DOF for it.
So you haven't really seen the full implications as yet then of the coronavirus increase. It was a dramatic increase in the number of people applying for universal credit.
Yeah.
The knock-on effect that is a huge increase in rate rebate.
Rebate, yeah.
That's, of course, the bills don't have to be paid to the start of July.
Yeah.
So have you any idea what sort of bill you're going to be landed with at the end of it?
Well, no, we have an estimate in there, 14 to 24 million, but again, that's just based on current figures. But as you quite rightly say, the numbers claiming universal credit is going up, so you would expect that those figures will go up as well. Now that there's been obviously an extrapolation on that estimate between the 14 to 24 million, but it's the best information they have at the moment.
And the worst case situation, do you feel you can cover that for the full financial year?
Well, what we're saying is no, we don't have it at the moment. That's why we have flagged it up to the centre. We're saying 14 to 24 million, the department cannot possibly cover. If it went up to 24 million, we couldn't. We're doing our best to cover the other pressures, but if that was to go up to 24 million, the pressure, in other words, we have, I think we had estimated it would be 16 million this year, would be the cost of rates rebate. Now we're saying that could go up to 40 million, and hence the potential pressure of 24 million.
But surely that hit shouldn't be taken by the department, that should come out of the coronavirus funding that's coming from Westminster.
Well, what we're saying, and that this was part of the whole reprioritisation exercise, that the executive is under pressure to fund everything that is required under COVID, which was why the reprioritisation exercise was started.
Okay. Thanks very much indeed. Paul?
Yeah, Stuart, thank you very much for your attendance here today, and sorry to ask too, of course. Can I ask Stuart, we've received three pages. You were here at this committee 2 weeks ago and explained that you had a delay because of the work doing monitoring around on the reprioritisation position. We've received three pages, and it just seems to be a monitoring round. The very next day, I was at the Justice Committee and received 40 pages of financial detail, of which I think there was 5 pages on June monitoring. Why have we received 3 pages?
Well, it was thought the committee, I mean, it is called a brief. I'm not sure that 40 pages is a brief. It depends on the level of detail that you, the committee.
We're, Stuart, thank you for providing a degree of levity today. We'll make sure that one is recorded. A civil servant who doesn't do briefs, right?
No, I mean, we're happy to work with the committee on the level of detail that you want from us, you know, but we also want to keep it that you can understand it and get through it. So we thought that we had attempted to do that, you know, happy to take that back if you feel that we're wrong on that. But,
yep. So my follow-on question, and I take your point, and, you know, we're not going to be unreasonable, but what's contained within those 3 pages, and this is a valid question, a sincere question, what's contained within those 3 pages that couldn't have been supplied 3 weeks ago?
Well, I think the...
Or 2 weeks ago, sorry.
What we're talking about, the estimates and the loss of income and things, there was work still being carried out in those areas, and that's what we said. And that is why we did say, and I did say last time, June monitoring and the reprioritisation did have to go hand in hand. You're quite right. It is a June monitoring exercise with the reprioritisation, you know, added on to it, and that's why you couldn't do one without the other.
I just feel underwhelmed about the reprioritisation. Because I was expecting to see big figures, big things. I was expecting to ask questions around the aspects of your budgets that are being ceased or stopped or slowing down. Now, I know you've talked about savings that amount to a total of 17.7 million. One of them being maintenance, 1.1 million. Just on the maintenance issue, a lot of people, when they're tightening belts, stop maintenance. But ultimately, it's usually a false economy. Can you give us more detail on the actual maintenance procedures that are ceased or stopping or slowing down?
Well, this is as much to do with the fact that we're now into June and some maintenance hasn't been carried out. They are very clear to say that they still need to cover statutory and health and safety elements of maintenance on that. But there is no doubt there is. You could spend twice as much as the budget we have on maintenance, and you are right. You know, there are things that you can stop more easily than other that may have more long-term effects, but we will certainly be looking at that. But this was very much an exercise where we were all being asked to tighten our belts, so we had to look at every aspect. And that's why, you know, it's okay, one of maintenance might, but we wouldn't want to go any further than that because we don't want to start impacting on statutory or health and safety requirements.
So how can you assure this committee then that it's not just basically a salami slice of savings, and that there is a strategic thought prioritisation process underway that actually looks at the priorities of the department and says, look, we've been doing this for so long. The benefits, cost benefits are minimal now. It's moved on. It's aged programme or policy we're doing, and we just need to cease it. Has there been anything like that within the reprioritisation?
Well, I think certainly all areas were asked to look at stuff that they could stop in the short term. But I think, yes, what you're talking about is a longer term strategic plan, and that's something that the department needs to do. This wasn't done in a short period of time. This was taking a reasonably quick look at stuff that could be stopped and given up at this time. But you're right, and constantly the department should be looking at what we're stopping. We're a department who provides services to a lot of other departments, so our actual, you know, budget, we've probably about 60% of it is staff costs, and then we've a lot of contracts. So between staff costs and contracts, that's about 90% of our budget. So we need to be, yes, we can always do better things, and there is a number of IT projects and things going forward to look to see how we can save money and produce things better, and that may result in reductions and more staff going forward. And I know you're smiling at that.
Sort of, the words IT and cost reduction for the Northern Ireland Civil Service don't quite go in the same sentence.
Well, one of the numbers I was expecting to see, and again I could be wrong in this, is that the Minister has stated that there's 100 million pressure. We're in the red, if you like, in the planning so far this year, so we're going to be overspent by 100 million. And that was all mostly down to the decision about the domestic and the non-domestic rates holiday. Does that go through, does that rates collection not go through the Department of Finance?
No, it doesn't go through the Department of Finance's budget. It's sort of held outside the Department of Finance, so that 213, if you like,
yes,
does not hit the department's budget per se.
Right,
hits
okay.
The blocks.
Yes.
Cost, if you like, but not specifically. Rates is outside.
Yep.
And Mr. Brown, I'm very sorry, but we've probably got a bit of a time constraint, and we also got some SLs to do, so just a very short.
Okay. Well, the last question then is about the LPS income. The 8.8, and we're probably going to have to come back on this because of the media interest this week, but can you give us some sort of brief answer as to how you've come up to that figure and how it will impact then going forward?
Well, that's based on looking forward, what income we would have had at the moment in the first quarter, and projecting that forward and estimating then how the housing market's going to go, and it looks to be that there probably will be a downturn on the housing market going forward. So land, 7 million of that is land registry cost, which is very dependent, as you know, on transactions in the housing market. So if that's going to go down, then the income's going to fall back. As you probably know from the papers, it's transactions-based. That's how the income is raised.
Yeah, okay. And thanks very much. And just on that one, Stuart, just before I let you go, because I couldn't let you go without saying this, Control and Auditor General's report, we did have LPS in front of us, and they never mentioned what the problems were. We did have the PermSec in front of us, and she never gave us any particular details on it. And for this committee to discover at this stage that basically we've been subsidising BT to the tune of 30 million quid, which I don't think anybody in this committee is going to be particularly happy about going forward. But it does raise a question when you look at LPS, because quite clearly in the Control and Auditor General's report says that many of the people of Northern Ireland have been overcharged and would be entitled to their money back. So that's going to be another pressure. So maybe that's something when you go back, we might look to get some detail on that. But thank you very much indeed. Sure.
Thank you, Janice.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Cheers. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, team, I'm going to try and sort of get us through as much as we can. Item number 6, subordinate legislation, census regulations. I draw members' attention to the following papers relating to this item. Clerk's briefing note on page 47, the SL1 census regulations, page 49. I'd like to inform members that the purpose of the census regulations is to make provision for the operational arrangements and procedures necessary for the conduct of the 2021 census, prescribe the paper questionnaires and provide details on the various online questionnaires that will be used in schedules to the regulations. The regulations are subject to the negative resolution procedure. I'd like to advise members of this committee's opportunity to consider the policy set out in the SL1, as it's not possible to amend this once the regulations have been made and led in the Assembly Business Office. I would like to seek your agreement.
Agreed.
Agreed. Okay. Members agree state that the committee has considered Department of Finance proposals for subordinate legislation census regulations Northern Ireland 2020 and has no objection to the policy implications on the proposed legislation at this stage. Content?
Content.
We move on to item number 7, subordinate legislation SL1, the business tenancies coronavirus restrictions on forfeiture relevant period Northern Ireland regulations 2020. I draw your members the attention to the clerk's briefing note on page 66, the SL1 on page 67, I advise members that the Department has requested that this SL1 be considered by the committee this week in order to ensure that the timelines coincide with the rest of those in our country. Inform the members that the Coronavirus Act 2020 Act provided that where non-payment of rent would usually enable a landlord to treat a lease as forfeited. That right would not be able to be exercised for a period of 3 months up to the 30th of June 2020, with the power to extend if that is needed. The Act brought in this provision separately in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. The statutory rule extends that period in Northern Ireland till 30th of September 2020. The regulations are subject to negative resolution procedure. This is the committee's opportunity to consider the policy set out in the SL1, as it is not possible to amend this once the regulations have been made and are laid in the Assembly Business Office. Are we content? Do we have agreement?
Content.
With your agreement, the committee has considered Department of Finance's proposal for subordinate legislation, the business tenancies coronavirus restrictions on forfeiture relevant period Northern Ireland regulations 2020, and has no objection to the policy implications of the proposed legislation at this stage. Thank you. We move on to agenda number 8, written briefing from Nilga and Solis, the joint written submission, Council's key to post-COVID social and economic recovery. Remind members that the committee agreed to receive a written briefing in order to gain a clearer understanding of the issues challenging councils once it is considered the department's position in the June monitoring round. I'd like to inform members the clerk's paper on Nilga written statement is at page 55 and the Nilga Solis written briefing is at page 56. Members, do we have any comments?
Chair, I would have a worry about, so we know that the councils were under pressure with regards to the financial transactions before COVID-19 emergency and the way the funding method was working. I suspect now with, you know, so many questions in my head around, now that we've made the decision about the rates, which was the right one,
mm-hmm.
how does that impact on council
mm-hmm.
with regards to rate base?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know that we've had that. It's nearly like a secondary thing where the Assembly has made this decision, which I support 100%, but then it's the impact on that, on the services that are provided through a lot of our rates, which is the councils for one, which will be the biggest hit, and just the impact on that and how it will actually play out in the year ahead. We also know that councils have had pressures and bother with regards to staffing levels and some of the debates around paying people off or furloughing them at that time. So I do think we need to have a greater understanding of how the decision that we all support with regards to the rates relief for businesses, how that actually impacts now on to the day-to-day running of a council, and then what we need to do to support the council. So I think we need to look at this as to how will that impact.
Any other comments? Okay. Well then, with that, Paul, if you want to provide us with some words so that we can add to, because I'm going to seek your agreement to write to the department, seek the detail of when financial forecasting will be provided to councils by LPS, an overview of the losses forecast for each district council, an overview of actual rates income received by each council in 2018-19-20. And I think that'll probably answer it.
That covers it. Yeah.
Are you happy with that?
Yep. Yep.
To ask officials to set out the end-of-year process that enables councils access district rates income that is paid to LPS. I think that is particularly germane at the moment.
Yep.
And I know Nilga is looking at that issue as well, and I think we're probably looking at it today or yesterday. And to establish what the impact of the rate-related decisions taken by the executive have in local government, i.e. does the executive cover the cost of rates income that is foregone by councils, four-month payment holiday and targeted rate support. Are we content with those?
Yeah.
I'd also like to seek agreement to inform Nilga of the committee's approach and to inform Nilga that the committee will update them again on receipt of the departmental response. Are we content?
Content.
Okay. Move on to item number 9, written briefing, consultation, administration of estates, Small Payments Act 1967. I want to draw members' attention to the department's intention to consult on a proposal to raise the small payments limit on distribution of assets on death without probate from 10,000 to 20,000. Ask members to consider it. Do we have any comments? Any? Ask the Speaker members are content with the consultation process. Content? Okay. There is no chairperson's business. Next item is number 11, correspondence. Update from the EU Affairs Manager regarding Ireland-Northern Ireland Protocol VAT provisions, which includes a response from HM Treasury to the Chair of the Economic Scrutiny Company, page 77. Matthew, do you want to comment on that?
If someone else wants to comment while I get the thing open again, because I seem to have lost my page and my tablet.
Because I know you will want to comment
on
it.
Yes, because I've been, yeah, but it's, yes, someone else can come in at any time. Yeah, I mean, I think this is speaking of letters from departments, it's pretty poor, really. The line in it, which is more generally, the government remains committed to publishing guidance for businesses in time to prepare for the end of the transition period, is weak, to say the very least. So I'm not sure that the best way to proceed, but it is clearly the application of VAT rules and how VAT operates within the protocol is one of the biggest issues businesses here face, particularly because it looks like we aren't going to get an extension. So I think this is something that we could pursue.
Just speaking as the chairman, but having read it and bearing in mind the question we're trying to do, because it's one of our biggest concerns about the additional burden of potential differential VAT rates and taxation issues, and we haven't had any response or detail in it at all, I don't think the letter answered any of my queries. And as a matter of fact, it's probably raised more questions than we answered. So I would like to seek your agreement to ask the department to, again, say that it's aware of the potential of any new costs and burdens on businesses in Northern Ireland as a result of the protocols, especially in relation to VAT and excise provisions. And I would propose that we write to them for further detail.
This is the Treasury Chair rather than the Department?
Well, first of all, the Department. I think you and I both know what the response we'd get out of the Treasury would be.
That doesn't mean we shouldn't ask. We had discussed earlier in the process about taking evidence from them, and you know that's a legitimate thing we could be considering doing, is asking them for.
May I put a consideration to the committee in the autumn, when hopefully at some stage in the early autumn we will have actually seen some form of detail on what is likely on sort of differential VAT rates and some of the sort of taxation regulation requirements. If we could then seek to get some evidence then from the Treasury, when we've actually got some detail to ask them some questions about.
Yeah.
Could I have your approval for that?
Yeah.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Next, correspondence from the Committee for the Economy regarding changes to the hardship fund criteria on page 86. Any comments? If we're happy to note, I would like to seek your agreement to note the remaining items of correspondence. Note, thank you. I'd like to seek agreement to note the information request to the department. We've done that. Sorry, move on. Look at the forward work programme. Updated forward programme is July 2020, is now at page 109. Members, are we content with the forward work programme so far? Agreed. Any other business? Advise members, the Northern Ireland Audit Office has issued its report on the land and property land web project. I've circulated that to you for perusal. Inform members, the Public Accounts Committee would normally have the first opportunity to consider this report. But Jim, you were saying the PAC saying that they're fairly...
Well, I'm not sure what web PAC are yet. They're meeting this afternoon, Chair, to...
If we ever let them in.
So,
is that what you said?
I think as soon as this committee leaves, the Public Accounts Committee will be in, I think.
Stay here.
Well, you volunteered.
I'd like to go for some sustenance or chocolate or something to keep me going.
I'd like to seek agreement to write to the PAC asking if it intends to consider the report further or if it's content for the Committee for Finance to do so. I'd also like to seek agreement to ask the Department when the Committee can expect to see proposals for a new fee order with the appropriate level of fees as recommended in the report as an urgent action. I think we can agree to that. Members, do you have any other additional areas of business?
The Queen. Sorry, just to the chair again, in reference to the letter we sent to the ministers.
Yeah. There was more changes. I think we had another change that came through from Matthew just before we were at the meeting. And I think we agreed that we will circulate it with the changes in, and then if we're all agreed with the changes, then we can get it sent.
Well, are you going to ask people to agree with these changes just by email, or?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you want to have another meeting about it? I don't think so. It's just...
Well, I thought it could have been dealt with here and now.
Well, actually, we dealt with this about an hour ago.
Yeah, we did.
And everybody agreed that we would have another draft circulated.
Yeah, that was agreed.
I don't remember that. Agreed now that another draft would be circulated with more changes on it. I thought that you said that we'd deal with that later on, that particular letter.
No. This was a different one, Melissa. No. Okay. Any other items of business? Time and place of next meeting. Next meeting, Wednesday the 24th of June at 12:30 in the Senate chamber.
Half 12. Can we hold that time? Great.
Okay, Gemma, cheers. Thank you. Thank you for all done.
Okay, thank you.
Cheers. Be safe.
Northern Assembly Senate Chamber, programme signed. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Senate Chamber.